so my name's Aneme Dlamini. I'm a student, and I'm here tonight because I want to learn about investing from the guest speaker, and I want to network. I want to get myself out there before I finish school. So this is the place to be, man.
Hey guys, my name is Michael Nell. I'm from a company called richboundmarketing.com. I'm at Startup Grind. It's super, super exciting, interesting. I love it, and I want to learn how to grow my business, and that's what I'm here to do. So I'm really excited.
It's not to be chatting to Monique Woodard. Now, Monique Woodard comes from a very small town in Florida. She now currently lives in Silicon Valley, and she's really, really pushing the diversity challenge. She's the founder of an organization called Black Founders. She's had one or two startups under her wing, and she's now one of the partners at 500 Startups. And this is allowing her to push the agenda at a global scale, which I think is really needed in this day and age. But it's also pretty interesting to note that she was selected for Woman an Award by San Francisco City as the Woman of the Month for History Month this month. So congratulations for that award. But even more interesting is that she used to actually be the president of a high school Spanish club. Ladies and gentlemen, Monique Woodward, please stand up.
Give her a warm welcome.
Startup Grind. Yeah. Thank you very much for joining us. Are you good there? Just watching those rolly chairs.
I'm going to try not to roll off the stage here.
So, the first thing that you do in Startup Grind is we ask you, where were you born and what was life like, etc. But my question to you today is going to be, tell us a little bit about Monique at age 5.
Sure. I don't remember a lot about myself at age 5, but so I'll tell you two things. So I was actually talking to someone earlier today who told me the story about buying a pair of sneakers, and he didn't realize that they were like these vintage sneakers. You wore them at the store and didn't take the box, which is apparently like a big thing when you buy a pair of vintage sneakers. And as a kid, like, I always wore the shoes at the store. Always. My mom still, to this day, reminds me, like, I never would let her put my old shoes on me. I wanted to wear the new shoes. So I'm all about the new shoes. And then the second thing is, you know, I came from a really small town. You know, didn't know anyone in tech, no one in my family was in tech. It's not like I grew up in Palo Alto or somewhere near Silicon Valley. But I asked for a computer at like age 7 and got one for Christmas. And so I think that that really set me on a path to, you know, whatever this is.
Changing lives, making computers, I like it. Okay. And what did your parents do?
When my dad worked fire and rescue for NASA, and my mom worked for Sprint. So, you know, fairly normal, middle class family from Florida.
You studied.
But I grew up on a farm.
You grew up on a farm?
I grew up on a farm in Ocala.
Next to a Silver Springs.
Yes.
Natural reserve state park next to a house. Did you play a lot in the woods there and stuff?
There was a lot of doing stuff in the woods, yeah.
Okay,
lots of like hunting, fishing, you know.
That's pretty cool. Okay. Very, very awesome outdoor life.
You know, I...
She just recovered there.
You know,
okay, so what made you go from the small town and having fun in the woods to actually studying BA of political science in Miami?
So I actually went to Hampton University first, which is in Virginia. Okay. It's an HBCU, a historically black college university. And a lot of my family went to Hampton. I got to Hampton and did not love it. And ended up moving to Miami and going to
You mean you were the president of the Spanish club, then you suddenly were this small fish in this big pond.
No, it was actually, the pond was really small.
Okay. And, you know, you want little
domination. I needed a bigger pond, I guess. And so, you know, I really like cities, and Miami is a big city. Mm-hmm. And so moved to Miami and studied there at University of Miami, and then spent 8 years there before I moved to San Francisco.
8 years, that's a long course. Wow.
Yes. It's a fun city. It's a lot like it too.
Did you, I mean, you're studying political sciences, and it's very government and policies and interesting, but also can be very boring.
Well, not really, because I was also minoring in the music industry. And,
wow.
And so one of my first jobs was for Luther Campbell, who is the former lead singer of Two Live Crew. So I was like negotiating his contracts, not like massive contracts,
yeah,
I was just out of college, but like, he was going on tour, and so I would advance his tour dates and make sure that he got paid by promoters, which, if you know anything about promoters, is an incredibly kind of stressful sort of thing. And so I would advance Luke's tour dates and make sure he got paid by promoters and make sure that they followed the contracts that were set. And yeah, all of that within the music industry.
Speaking of music, a little birdie told me that you freestyle.
I do not freestyle. I don't know who told you that. I have been forced to freestyle at a company retreat.
There you go.
And I hope that video never surfaces.
All right, so tell us, how did you go from, you know, doing the music thing, you worked for a bit for the government as well?
So that came much later. So I was in the music industry for a while, but I always sort of found myself, I taught myself how to code and taught myself how to like build websites. And then I knew absolutely nothing that there was like this venture capital industry on the other side of the world where you could go and they would give you money. And so I just made websites make money. And so I bootstrapped a lot of websites and figured out how to use performance marketing and affiliate marketing, figuring out how to like drive traffic and just figuring out how to make things make money.
How did you figure that out?
I spent a lot of time on IRC and in chat rooms and talking to other people who were doing similar things and just figured it out on my own.
You mean you spent the time, did the groundwork,
right,
the timing, the effort?
And figured out like things that people were doing back then, like traffic trades and building a traffic pump and figuring out how to send more traffic to your website by building other websites around it. So doing things like that that people did like in the late 90s or so to drive traffic to websites. And got really good at it and made money at it. And then eventually the performance marketing companies noticed that I was good at that and was making a lot of money from them. They asked me to come on the product side and build product. So I went on the product side and built product for them. And then a company in San Francisco noticed what I was doing and recruited me. They asked me to come out to San Francisco, and I was not really trying to move to San Francisco. I was like having a great life in Miami doing my thing. And I went for a day and had a conversation with them, and on the way back, they made me a job offer. And I didn't have a reason to say no, so I said yes.
That's a good reason to say
which
yes.
Is often the way that I make decisions. And I highly recommend it. Like, if you just try saying yes to lots of things, and eventually, you know, some things will be complete utter shit, but, you know, there will be a lot of things that happen that, a lot of great things that come out of that. And so I think that moving to San Francisco at the time that I did in 2008 was the right move for me and really, really set me up for all of this.
Tell us about Black Founders organization. How did it come about?
Yeah, so after moving to San Francisco, like I was going to like demo days and I was really getting deeply involved in the startup community in Silicon Valley. And I would go to all of these things, and I would notice that there were never any other Black people there. But then I ran into three other Black people who were also there and either starting companies or working for startups, or my friend Chris Bennett, he was starting a company, and my friend Nena, she was a lawyer for startups. And then we kind of all gravitated toward each other And then one night we went to dinner and we said, well, why don't we start a community for Black entrepreneurs? And so we kind of very hastily registered the domain Black Founders right on my phone sitting right there in that restaurant. And then we just planned our first event. And people actually came, which we were shocked about. And
was it mostly Black people that came, or was it a very diverse?
Yeah, it was mostly Black people, Black founders, people who were.
Was it open to everybody, or was it only for?
All of our events have always been open to everyone. But what we found was that Black entrepreneurs really wanted some sort of community and wanted to come together and talk about the challenges that they were experiencing, the great things and the bad things. They also wanted, you know, help on things like how do you build a pitch deck, what do you say to investors, all of these sorts of things. So it started to go beyond like just a happy hour, which is really where we started. And we started to do these educational events in San Francisco. And then people started to notice what we were doing because we were tweeting about it on Twitter. And then they were asking us, well, when are you coming to New York? And when are you coming to Atlanta? And mind you, we all had startups or we had jobs in tech.
So you're doing this as a startup.
And so we were, right. Yeah. And so, you know, eventually we did. We started this Ideas Are Worthless conference, and we took that to Atlanta, and we took it to New York. And it was really about getting people to move from I have an idea about something to being able to execute on that idea. And then we started doing programs at historically Black colleges and universities as a way to kind of build the pipeline into technology and into Silicon Valley. And you know, it really started to grow from like just a happy hour into this full-fledged community, much like Startup Grind, you know?
And you just went across the whole of America?
Yes, we did. We've done events all across America. We have members from all over the US. And then soon after that, I started a company built an app called Speak Chic in the fashion tech space. But then I really wanted to work on problems that touch a large and really diverse set of users. And there are only a few places you can do it. You can do it at like Google and Facebook, right? Because they're massive. There's major scale there. But if you really want to do it, you go to government. You work on government technology. And so I took kind of my product, my consumer product chops, and took that to government. And so worked on product from a government perspective, figuring out what problems.
How did you get into the government? Was it through?
The U.S. has a fellowship at the federal level called the Presidential Innovation Fellowship. And in San Francisco, they saw that and, you know, put together a fellowship of their own called the Mayor's Innovation Fellowship. And because San Francisco happens to be really innovative, and we have a chief innovation officer, we have, you know, there's a culture of innovation even within government. So we were able to do a lot of really interesting things around space building and placemaking, and things that I did, like wrote the mayor's resolution on unlicensed spectrum, and, you know, tried to figure out ways to roll out broadband massively across the city. And so that was a really interesting way to think about products. And from my perspective, I was looking for ways to create more empathy in the products that I was building, because, you know, you have people who speak different languages, you have people from different socioeconomic backgrounds, but they all need to use, you know, city services.
Yeah.
And so how do you really connect with people of all backgrounds who need to use these services and, you know, come from many different types of walks of life?
The with this broadband and the rolling it out, did you find something? I know that it helps to, apparently every percent that you get further in with your rollout of broadband, you also get a higher GDP for that area, etc., mm-hmm. etc. Did that program actually roll out, and was there an actual increase in GDP or in seeing the upliftment of the areas?
So we have rolled out, the city of San Francisco has rolled out broadband in certain areas. Primarily in the business corridors. I was personally really interested in seeing it roll out in places like Chinatown and Bayview, which are lower socioeconomic communities, but really, you know, the most disconnected communities in San Francisco. I think eventually we will get there, the city of San Francisco will get there, where, you know, broadband and access to internet is touching all of these places. But I think right now there's a large focus on business corridors and how they can make those business corridors kind of a draw for people.
How did you go from that into $500?
So after my fellowship period, I wrapped up some projects with the city and was thinking about my next step and really thinking about access to capital for Black and Latino founders, but also kind of also noticing the shifting demographics in the U.S. And so someone from 500, I had known 500 for a while and been to their demo days, and my co-founder and Black founders, Chris Bennett, is a 500 startups portfolio company, and I know Deshaun Amira, who's also a 500 startups founder, really well, and so I kind of knew, I knew 500, knew Dave and Christine, and someone asked me to come and chat about what I was going to be doing next and how I, what I was doing with Black Founders. And so during that meeting, I kind of like, in this very offhand kind of way, said, oh yeah, and I'm thinking about like doing some SPVs, doing some special purpose vehicles, or like doing an angelist syndicate, or maybe I'll raise a full-fledged fund. And they were like, oh, well, tell us more about that thing you just said. Like, don't bury the lead. And so I told them more about, you know, the way that I was thinking about the market and the U.S. demographics that I was seeing shift, and what I thought an interesting thesis could be for a fund. And after, you know, meeting with a few different people within 500 startups, I met with Marvin Lau and Elizabeth, who run the Accelerator program. They're great. And met with Dave and Christine, of course, eventually, and went to a team retreat so I could see all the craziness up close. And you know, once it seemed like we were really very much aligned in both culture and, you know, and desired outcomes, I decided to start raising a fund, one of the microfunds within 500 startups.
Okay, so did you ever invest in a company before 500 startups?
No, I had only advised companies.
Advised. Yeah. Okay, and. joining 500 startups and are doing, give me a second there. Okay, so with 500 startups, what exactly, for those, because a lot of people in the room, you don't even know 500 startups. They do now, right, here we go. What exactly does 500, 60 seconds, what's your elevator pitch for 500 startups?
Sure, so 500 startups is a venture fund and accelerator based in San Francisco and Silicon Valley, but investing very much globally. We are currently on Fund 4. We've done 1,800 investments over... 1,800 investments. Over about 9 years. And we also have microfunds all over the world, Japan, Korea, and, as well as vertically oriented microfunds like the Mobile Fund and My Fund, which is currently being raised, the 500 Shades Fund.
That is quite impressive. How do you keep track of all of that stuff?
You know, people much smarter than I am keep track of a lot of that stuff. We have a great legal team, great accounting team, great accelerator.
Any great exits in those last 9 years?
Sorry?
Any great exits in the last
9 years? So we are one of the investors in Twilio, which recently went IPO. We're also in Credit Karma, which is a unicorn. We're also in Grab Taxi out of Asia, which is also a unicorn in our portfolio. We also have more than 30 companies that we consider centaurs, so worth between $100 million and $1 billion.
Okay, just to explain, so, a unicorn is a company that's over a billion, with over $1 billion.
Worth over $1 billion.
So that's upwards, et cetera. Mm-hmm. Okay, so some of the questions here is, what is the most exciting, interesting startup you have come across in your journey?
Oh gosh, exciting, interesting.
Mackenzie!
So just on this trip, let's just time box it to the Geeks on a Plane trip. We saw some really interesting startups in Accra. I definitely think that those were some of the strongest pitches that I've seen lately, not just in Africa, but you know, even from some of the U.S. pitches that I've seen.
Is it global or is it local problems that they're solving?
There were definitely local problems. One is a sort of a CMS for construction, and you know, they came out of the MEST program, and I think that that program is creating extremely strong entrepreneurs, and I was incredibly impressed by them.
That's really cool. Yeah. Can innovation startups in cutting-edge tech, VR, biotech, AI, realistically thrive if funded in Africa, or should there be a strong bias for that?
You know, I think there's opportunity for all sorts of startups in all sorts of markets. And I'll tell you a little story. So I came to Africa for the first time early last year, and I made three trips after that, but my very first trip, I met a company, and they were like, we were talking about VR. And I was sort of like, I don't really see the opportunity for like VR in Nigeria, where there are so many other issues that you could be solving, so many other problems that tackle like base of the pyramid, that tackle all sorts of things in Nigeria, infrastructure, like you have all of these challenges that you could be putting your mind towards, so why would you focus on VR? So then, you know, time goes on, I leave with that thought in my head, and then I come back, and I meet someone, and they're doing VR for education, and they're pumping education content to places in the rural areas who don't have access to teachers using VR.
That's incredible.
Now completely wrong, right?
Yeah.
So, and that was the reason why I went to Nigeria over and over again, because you can go to a place and then think you know something and think you have like this opinion about what people should and shouldn't be doing in Cape Town, but you don't really know anything until you're here more than once or twice. Mm-hmm. Until you really start to understand people and start to talk to people and understand what the needs are and understand what the problems are and understand how people are solving those problems using technology. So, I mean, I change my mind all the time.
Well, it's good. You've got a mind and you're allowed to change it. There we go. How does a startup, what are you, especially in your Black and Latino fund, what are you looking for in startups?
Yeah, so I guess I should let's back up a little bit and just talk about why there's a fund, and it's focused on, you know, tech categories that are going to see high growth of Black and Latino consumers. So if you look at the U.S. data, people of color will become the majority in the U.S. by the year 2040. And of that people of color majority, Black and Latinos will be 37%. So that's a huge, huge number, and it's a huge, huge shift. Black and Latino consumers have a combined $2.5 trillion annual spending power in the U.S. And that's grown 70% in the last 13 years. And so it's a huge market, spending power is growing, but yet if you look at technology, it's completely underserved. You know, Dollar Shave Club, great company, great outcome, bought by Unilever. But if you talk to Black men or anyone with coarse and curly hair, which are a lot of ethnic people, Dollar Shave Club is completely unusable. Completely. Because Black men get razor bumps. And people with coarse and curly hair, who are usually ethnic people, get razor bumps. And so then you look at a product like Bevel, Tristan Walker's company, which we're investors in, and you see a founder who's identified a problem and is really addressing it for a very, very specific part of the market, and that part of the market is large and growing in size and in spending power. And so I see those opportunities and those gaps in the tech market all the time, where people have created products that really only serve a very specific piece of the market, but are leaving a lot of people outside of that. You know, Drybar great company based in the U.S. It's sort of you. It's a woman's salon. You go in. It's like an hour, and you get your hair. I can absolutely not go to a dry bar, like for any reason. like my friends and I have horror stories of when we've been desperate and tried to go to a dry bar, and it has not worked out well. And so you see like all of these issues where people have created companies that serve only a segment of the market, and that segment of the market is suddenly not going to be the majority anymore. And so what do you do then? And so I've identified a piece of the market that is large, that is growing, and is growing in influence. And that is where I spend my time investing. So that is sort of the backstory of 500 Shades. It's really, people talk about diversity related to 500 Shades all the time. Yes, it's going to make the 500 Stars portfolio even more diverse than it already is, but really, it's simply about demographics and the way that U.S. economics is shifting and moving. So that's really what 500 Shades is all about, and why I invest in those companies.
It's pretty cool. The future.
It is the future.
If you guys have any questions, please do feel free to ask. Put your hand up. We're going to carry on some questions here. Why do you think there is such a shortage of black entrepreneurs? Do you think it's ability or opportunity?
So I don't think there's, it comparatively, in the space, there's not a huge shortage of black entrepreneurs. There is a shortage of black entrepreneurs getting VC funding.
Okay.
And, you know, you can talk about lots of things related to that. You can talk about access to networks, which is really important. You can talk about investor bias, which is also a factor. You know, I've definitely seen the number of black entrepreneurs growing. Black and Latino women happen to be the fastest growing group of entrepreneurs in the U.S.
Wow.
322%
growth.
Thank you, Beth.
Thank you. Very good.
So those numbers are growing exponentially. So there is no shortage, but there is a shortage of those founders getting access to funding. And I think part of that is the way that venture capital funds look. If you go to the pages of a venture capital fund, and you look at it, most of those people are like older white men. And there are very few black women, there are very few black men. Like I could literally sit here and tell you all of the black men in venture capital. All of the black women in venture capital.
So how do we get
and it wouldn't take
them,
very long.
How do we get more of the high net worth black or Latino individuals to get into that space?
You know, I think most people don't know about venture funds and have never invested in venture funds. So it's a lot of education about what it is to invest in a company as an angel, what it is to take a minority investment in a company as opposed to taking a majority investment in the company, which we see a lot in emerging markets, especially in Africa, Asia, different places. So I think it's a lot of education, which we do quite a bit of through our programs VC Unlocked. So it's education and having people move from investing in things like real estate or other things, or the stock market, and investing in venture. And it shouldn't be a huge part of your portfolio, but I think there's an opportunity for it to be a significant part of your portfolio, especially if you understand that the next generation of really impactful entrepreneurs is going to come from the tech industry.
Tell us about KISS.
KISS stocks?
Yeah.
Oh, yes. That could mean a lot of things. So KISS docs are a set of documents that 500 startups released, very easy convertible note docs. And they're widely available on the internet. Lots of startups use them.
Is it globally applicable, or is it just for the US?
So they were created specifically for U.S. companies, but they have been, and Veggie, please correct me if I'm wrong, but they have been translated for many other countries other than the U.S. Okay, so and they're used, right? They're used fairly widely.
That's pretty cool. Okay, any questions? There we go. Just get a microphone for a bit. So we've also got documents called Series C or Seed Series in South Africa.
Hi, can you hear me, Teddy?
Yes.
Thank you, Monique. So I'm sure out of all the startups you've seen, you've probably come across founders or co-founding teams that have very powerful visions for the future and kind of eccentric and have a very singular vision that's very unique. And what I want to find out is, how do you deal with that and what advice would you give to them? Especially if they're very paranoid to give up control, you know, and the classic example is Steve Jobs getting kicked out of Apple by his board because he had such a desire to really control the vision of where the company was going. So I just want to find out from your perspective, what advice would you give and how would you deal with them from your perspective as an investor?
I think founders with a strong point of view are great. I think you can have a strong point of view and not be, you know, a complete
douchebag.
Sure. not be, you know, someone that no one wants to work with. I think worse than having a strong point of view and understanding what you want for your company is like taking everyone's advice and constantly asking people what they think you should be doing with this company. Like, I'm not here to run your company. I'm here to give, like, this advice is free. Like, you can take it or not. maybe it's good, maybe it's bad, but you can take pieces of information from many different people and do what you want to with it. I don't think having a strong point of view is bad. I think, you know, not being able to work with people and, you know, being a douchebag is bad, but, you know, where's the line? I don't know.
This is actually a question ties in with two questions. One is, how can South Africans work more closely with 500 startups or with Silicon Valley investors? And then that leads into, do you see inherent economical or geographical risks in investing in South African businesses?
So the first part of that question, we have four accelerator cohorts per year in Silicon Valley. So that is certainly one way to work closely with 500 startups is by being in one of our accelerator programs. The other, you know.
How do you get into those programs?
You apply. Applications are currently still open for batch 21.
Okay.
Closing really quickly. So
13 hours, so
if you want to get in, get on it.
Is anybody from the world, can anybody from the world apply?
Anyone from the world can apply. We always have a lot of international companies in our accelerator. We are not, geographically fixed. So, you know, we really love companies that come from other places outside of the U.S. And then I've also been working on the continent to increase our investment in African startups. We've done roughly 10 deals on the continent. And it tends to be about one or two per accelerator batch, but even outside of that, we've done seed deals as well. And we've invested in companies in Nigeria, Ghana, Kenya, South Africa, and that's it so far.
Okay,
in sub-Saharan Africa.
Okay, what stage must that be at?
You have to have a working product on the market. We don't really invest in idea stage companies. We do seed through Series A. We have both a seed program, so a seed accelerator, as well as a Series A program, which was formerly called our Distro Dojo. We hold our Distro Dojo in London and LA. And really, that program is all about getting people getting companies who are ready, about to be ready to go out for Series A, getting them ready and increasing their marketing and getting them ready for that Series A raise.
Yeah, and then do you see the economic or geographical risks?
Yeah, I don't see so much geographic risk, but there is certainly emerging market risk, I would call it. And, you know, some of the challenges are, you know, access to downstream capital. So VCs who put their capital in after us. There is often a limited amount of capital in some of these markets, and so who is going to come in after us and continue to put in money or put in money alongside us? You know, there's also some risk around the types of companies that are coming out of some of these markets. There are certainly markets where I think we probably would not do a pure consumer internet play, like, you know, a Snapchat style company probably wouldn't be something that we would do in Nigeria, for instance, let's say. Although, you know, maybe my mind would change just like VR. But I don't think so, only because, you know, that was a company for a long time in search of a business model, and I think it's going to be really important for a lot of these companies to have some sort of a business model, some sort of revenue model to help them get through a little bit of a leaner venture capital market.
How do you go about, because you're raising a $25 million, I mean, that's a micro fund, but like, mm-hmm. South Africa would be like huge. How do you go about raising that money, raising that fund?
You knock on a lot of doors.
You hustle.
Right? You knock on a lot of doors. You ask your VC friends for intros. So, you know, you go out after limited partners who are typically family offices, high net worth individuals or accredited investors, you know, at some levels, pension funds and endowments, as well as corporates. And, you know, you talk about your thesis and you talk about how you're seeing the market and you hope that they get excited about it. And then tactically, you know, you take your friends out, other VC friends out for coffee and ask them to introduce you to people who have invested in their funds or have not invested in their funds but might invest in your fund.
Okay. Yeah. Sounds like a lot of work, right?
It's a lot of work.
A lot of fun. Any other questions out there? I see no hands. There it goes, one at the back and one right next door. Check.
Hi, Monique. Through my reading, I identified that a lot of investors identify perseverance as one of the key characteristics of entrepreneurs. Like Foreground, for instance, calls them cockroach startups. Like Airbnb, for instance, was just a startup that wouldn't die.
Yeah.
In your experience, what would you say is the most important characteristic? Maybe it's the same that you identified in investing in entrepreneurs.
Yeah, I mean, keep showing up. I think, you know, for me, a lot of the times when I've won, it's just because I just kept showing up and would not stop and was relentless about what I was doing. And so, you know, it's not easy to get out of bed every day and, like, you know, go build a startup when, you know, you feel like sometimes it's tanking. But, you know, continuing to show up is what separates a good founder from a great founder. I also say, you know, just on a practical level, controlling your burn. Like, the lower your burn can be, the more agile you can be as a founder and as a company. I see a lot of founders who, you know, I ask them how much money they're spending per month, and it's some crazy astronomical amount, and they're at the end of their runway, and they need to raise money immediately. Well, that puts you in a really tough position with investors. One, investors don't necessarily like to invest in companies when you are at your most desperate point, when you've got $2,000 in the bank and, you know, you really need this check. It's probably not the best time. And, you know, I look at how much money a company is spending per month and how much runway they have as a signifier of how healthy that company is. So, you know, on the one side, that's sort of ephemeral, yes, persevere and, like, keep going for it. On the other side, that's completely practical, control how much money you're spending every month.
Okay, there's a question in the front here.
Hi there. I wanted to know what are some of the most unexpected lessons you learned from the African continent when it comes to investment and startups in general. And then, of course, you also mentioned that there isn't a shortage of black entrepreneurs. It's, you know, VC funding, you know, connecting it. How do you think we can kind of bridge that gap and solve that issue?
Okay, so what is the most surprising thing? I don't know that anything has particularly surprised me. You know, I think that, you know, we came into this market with our eyes open and really wanting to understand how the many different markets on the continent worked, and they're, each one of them is completely different. And so every time you go to a new place, it's a little bit of a readjusting and reshifting and continuing to try to understand what that particular market is, one, good at, what the problems are, and what the challenges and opportunities might be. So I think, you know, every market is going to be different, and it's a constant recalibration every single time. So, and then the second question, I think that, you know, the rise of micro VCs, so sub $50 million funds, right, has really allowed a lot of different VCs to come to the table and invest in a lot of companies that probably wouldn't have gotten funded before, not because they were not good companies, but because they might not have had the access to capital. You know, larger funds might not have looked at them. So you take folks like Troy Carter and Marlon Nichols over at Cross Culture VC, Kirsten Green over at Forerunner. You take all of those sorts of micro VCs, Cowboy Ventures, Eileen Lee. Like, you have a lot of women who are now at the table. You have a lot of African Americans who are now at the table. You have a lot of people who might not have gotten a shot inside a larger venture fund, but now they've gone out and raised these funds and are putting money to work and putting money into deals that look a lot different, but that are seeing some major success.
I see. So Aisha is here. Hello, Aisha.
Hey.
So they actually went through, so there's Aisha, you can chat to her what it looks like. They spent 3 months in the Valley, going through the Farmer to Startup program. So you can chat to them how hard it is actually to get in and what all their learnings are and stuff. So grab her afterwards. And is there any, I'm going to take one last question. It's right at the back, the hands right there. And we can end with this. Sorry for going out of time, guys.
Hi, Monique.
Hey.
I would like to know if you had any failures as an entrepreneur, and how did you overcome them?
Sure. I mean, I had lots of failures. I built Speak Chic, and it got really good traction within the fashion industry, but I didn't feel like it was really going to be a very big venture backable company. And I started going out and trying to raise an angel round and wasn't getting a huge amount of traction when it came to angel investors. And had to really go back and reevaluate the product and figure out.
So what did Speak Chic just say?
Sorry, so Speak Chic, it was a mobile app that helped you pronounce fashion brand names and use pronunciation to lead you into brand discovery. So if you like 3.1 Philip Lim, you will also probably like the Kuhn. And so it sort of became this interesting cult product within the fashion industry, but I didn't really feel like it was going to get mainstream adoption. And so I had to eventually cut that product loose. So that was certainly a failure. Yeah.
But you had amazing learnings from that.
Well, yeah, I mean, I have amazing learnings. I really like building things. So I never think of the time that I spent building something as time wasted. Even now, sometimes I get like the itch to build something, and I'm like, maybe I should just spend the weekend and spin up a thing. And I'm like, no, it's time for that. Maybe I should take a nap.
It's a problem.
But yeah, I think that, you know, those sorts of failures, you know, one, you learn a lot of skills from doing anything like that. You learn how to fundraise, you learn how to build a product, you learn how to get people to download and get people to buy something from you. So I think all of those things are learnings that you can roll into something that is much more viable. And you just have to know there's a difference between perseverance and like continuing to like ram your head against a wall when it's not going to be a big outcome for you or for anyone else. And you have to know when to persevere versus when to cut bait.
That's tricky.
It's tricky, yeah.
That's really tricky. All right, guys, thank you very much. We're going to have the Twitter competition taking place.